Hello and welcome back to a new video here in the DirectX 12 video series on YouTube. We are back again at the video 3 GPU descriptors and root signatures. Today only talking about root signatures because well, descriptors were done last video. Before we get into the nice things of a root signature, I want to briefly discuss what we have already accomplished and also revisit the descriptor heap so that you get on the point where we are currently are and that everything is a bit more understandable. So let's start by what we have accomplished a few videos ago. We have accomplished the creation of a heap, so allocating memory on the GPU and allocated some memory on it for example, let's say textures and buffers. So all the stuff we want to draw or contains information for drawing. After that, we have also implemented a shader. So a program that knows how to draw or that contains the logic to draw in combination with pipeline states that that configure the GPU and also contains the shaders to know how the GPU is configured for drawing. We also had a kind of like root signature on that pipeline state, but kind of like just imagine this is not created right now. So what did we do then? Then we described descriptor heaps and also descriptors. So kind of like blocks of memory that defines how textures, buffers, how memory is accessed on the GPU. So we kind of like put some information inside a heap on the GPU that can tell some other part of the GPU how to access data. Now what is missing is actually the part that directly binds to the shader that actually references these descriptors and the heap, and this is called the root signature. By default, you can actually directly link data from the root signature to the, or directly link data to the root signature without using a descriptor heap, but it doesn't work for everything, for example, not for textures, because textures require additional information. And not for samplers, because samplers also require different informations. So that's why we need some descriptors. But what we can do, of course, is we can actually bind with the root signatures the shader to a descriptor heap. Or a descriptor inside a descriptor heap. Actually, you can only have one heap of each type bound to the pipeline at one time. It's a restriction there, but it is not a problem because you would do some more memory management there. So actually this is kind of like the hard and soft link, because the descriptor heap can soft link to heap elements and the root signature can be soft linked to descriptor heaps, but the root signature is statically linked to a shader. So the shader kind of like has the root signature baked in. The root signature is more kind of like an intermediate data, like a buffer. So you actually never see the root signature in kind of like production code, because in production code the root signature is just a row of bytes or kind of like a virtual address table which gets linked to either memory or either heaps. So yeah, now let's actually take a look at how root signatures are built up and what their parameters are. First of all, root signatures are kind of like the shader side declaration of heap elements, or they are used in combination with the shader side declaration of heap elements. So you can actually declare everything that a shader would need, a shader resource view, a constant buffer view, or an unordered access view. But also things like samplers, and also, we've never discussed them before, constants. So values that are just baked into the root signature. Kind of like, normally you would interpret the root signature as a kind of like memory pointer to a descriptor or a memory pointer to the heap. But you could also interpret this as raw data, for example, a float 32-bit. So yeah, it can be also some constant values in there. But now comes the special thing. The root signatures are set explicitly at runtime. So before the pipeline state is used for drawing. Of course, the root signature is kind of like a static thing you define before while compiling the shaders. But in real time, the root signature is just a block of memory, exactly 64 DWords, so 64 times 32-bit. And just a block of memory on the GPU that contains some data, either pointers or raw data. So you have to explicitly, after a root signature was set on the GPU, you have to explicitly go in and say, set the following value at the following index of the root signature to kind of like the address of that buffer to the index of the descriptor in the following heap, and you have to manually go in and define it. I already told you the 64 D words big, but it can also be that it is less in size on the GPU, which doesn't mean that bigger root descriptor root signatures fail, but they will be slower because they are stored, let's say, in VRAM and not directly on the die. So you would have actually some latency because you need to access the RAM, and this is the VRAM, and even though the VRAM is amazingly fast on modern GPUs, it still is kind of like a bottleneck, because memory is always a bottleneck, buses are always a bottleneck if you're doing some compute intensive tasks. So actually this could hold you back. So yeah, you should keep the root signature as small as possible. So what can you actually put on that root signature? I already told you that you can put kind of like pointers and values on the root signature. And there's actually a description here. So constants can be of any arbitrary data type. You could define kind of like a big array or everything else on the root signature is true. Even though you will probably don't want to use the, you won't use that because, well, it's bad to actually define too many data on the root signature, maybe just some few parameters there, because it will eat up space very fast. Because imagine you can only set 64 constants, and if you use the 64 constant, then you have no space for other things. So you should probably use a constant buffer, for example, directly on the root signature, which is fast if you use it directly on the level 1, because it just requires one pointer to be looked up. But it also requires two dwords, because, well, we have 64-bit address, so two dwords for one address. Same goes for unordered access views and also for shader resources view, even though I've not put them in here, because most of the time shader resource views are textures and they are not allowed on level 1 root signature, they are only allowed in tables. But there are some special shader resources here that are allowed, for example, ray tracing acceleration structs, and there was another thing which used that, I forgot it, sorry. But there are cases in which you would put a shader resource view also on the root of the root signature. Next thing you can do is actually a table. The table just requires one dword, because it's just an offset into a descriptor heap, and this offset is 32-bit. And it defines kind of like the starting point of a array of descriptors, which then again describes, for example, shader resource view, constant buffer views, universal unordered access views, and samplers. Actually, either shader resource views, constant buffer views, or unordered access views, or separate samplers. Samplers also always require a different list, because they are also in a different descriptor heap. So the table is kind of like a link to a descriptor heap starting point, and depending on how many things you actually write inside this table on the shader side, statically on the shader side, the table will be indexed, and you have to make sure that the actual descriptor heap is big enough and contains valid data. You are also allowed to define static samplers. They are actually kind of like a special thing, because they require no memory at all, because they just can't be kind of like hard-coded inside the shader. The GPU, the compiler, can directly just eliminate them out of the root signature and just straightforward use them in the application. So here are some examples for root signatures. Let's start explaining the first one. We start with a float 4 constant, so 4 floating point values, which would mean 4 dwords, so 4 bytes of, not 4 bytes, 4 dwords used. And as you can see, they are indexed by 0, 1, 2, 3, so by 0 based index on the left. This is important. This is used for the C++ side, and it is continuously. So it starts by the first element you declare and ends at the last. You cannot influence that order. There's another thing which is called B3 here, which is the register. Also, you can use spaces there, but I will come to that concept a bit later. Next thing is a descriptor table. As you can see, it's just kind of like one block high, so it is one dword big. and it points to the start of a descriptor heap, which with a valid descriptor, and you just then define, for example, in this case, five elements inside that descriptor table, and the GPU will just increment the stored index here to get to the right element, in this case, two shader resource view, two constant buffer views, and unordered access view. Next is another table, which points to two samplers. And last, another direct link here, in this case, a root constant buffer view on the slot B0 here. And if you would sum them up, you have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 DWords used for that root signature. There are also a example for more advanced root signatures. Let's take a look at this one again. And especially, we're going to take a look at the shader resource view. Actually, let's go from directly start at the shader resource view. Let's start at the first one. So we have a shader resource view at the slot or at the register T0. Then we have a shader resource view at the register T1. Then we have a shader resource view below there at T2. And we have a shader resource view array at T3. And this is actually quite a nice thing which you can do on root signature. So you can give HLSL a array of unknown size, so you don't know how big this array is. You can actually change this at runtime. You could reserve kind of like, let's say, 265 descriptors in that array where you point with that array, and you could dynamically fill them if required, or you could leave some things unchecked and just with, for example, with that constant here, give the GPU a hint on which array index lookup should be performed. So you kind of like define, okay, this is now an unbound array. But the thing is that by defining an index T3 on an unknown array size, the GPU cannot determine when this registers will overflow. So which the next usable index is, which is quite bad because, well, now every register from T3 up to infinity is occupied by this unbound or unknown size shader resource view array. So you can't use any more shader resource views. And this is actually a problem because, well, maybe you want to have two arrays, or I don't know, you have an array and you want to add some other shader resource view again, but the array was already defined, so you would have to go into so many shaders and change code so that they use kind of like the new indices so that you can fit a new normal shader resource view in there, and this is very bad. And so they came up with a concept called spaces. So by default, everything is in space 0, so this actually means space 0, register 0, space 0, register 1, space 0, register 2, space 0, register 3, and so on. And now, as you can see, we want to have another table. We need to go into the next space because, well, the old space is already fully occupied. So I just define space 1 and texture register 0 and ongoing. So now I would have in space 0, define T0, T1, T2 to 1, and T3 up to infinity of an unknown array size, and in space 1, T0 up to infinity on another array. So, yeah. Actually, there's another thing called aliasing. You can actually overlap to kind of like descriptors to the same slot. So, in this case, on this table, there are actually two elements inside of this table, or actually three elements, U3, U4, and U5, but because of how the root signature was built up, they, U4 and U5, are actually alias of each other. They point to the same descriptor. There's another signature here on the right, but let me just skip them because we already discussed about them in depth. So how do I now explain a root signature in HLSL? As you can see, we have another root signature here, and we can directly see how that translates to HLSL. Root signatures are defined by the keyword hashtag define, so we just define a preprocessor constant, and later on we can use them inside the shaders to actually define this shader is using my RS1 in this case, so this shader uses that root signature. First of all, we have some flags. I will go into the detail of them in the next slide, so just be patient. And then I have defined a CBV, which directly maps to this first constant buffer view. So CBV at register B0, okay, B0, and space equals 1, okay, space equals 1. After that, I have bound a shader resource view, just very basically, just a register, nothing more. Universal access view, a register, some parameters. I will go into the details of then in the next few slides. Then I have bound a table. This is something special because we kind of like have a block here with some brackets here. And inside this table, we also already define a new constant buffer view. In this case, again at the register B0, but because we have not specified a space, it's space 0. Then we have a universal unordered access view, a shader resource view, another table of two descriptors. And actually here you can see if you specify unbound kind of like as a string, then num descriptors is unbound. So yeah, it's not no need to put a minus one or a big number in there. Just put in unbound and everything is fine. So there we have a descriptor table of samples. Then we have a root constant. It's a bit special, but we go into the detail on how they work in a few slides. And another table and some static samplers. And static samplers are always put aside because they don't count into the kind of like real mapping. So you would always want to put static samples at the last on the root signatures on the lowest positions because they also get no address. Now let's continue on to the root flags. I told you that I cannot tell you about this a bit more, and root flags are kind of like some basic definitions of the root signature. There are some flags that allow things and flags that deny things. For example, allow input assembler input layout means that I just enable the input assembler input layout. Allow stream output allows a stream output on this shader or from this data. So yeah, there's also flag down here. And then we have several deny attributes because you may have a shader that is implemented, for example, let's say a geometry shader, but that the geometry shader is just offsetting vertices by their kind of like input parameters and doesn't require a access to some of the data inside the root signature. Then you could actually define that the, let's say, geometry shader is not using it. So you say flag deny geometry shader root access, which would mean that DirectX can skip all that initialization for the geometry shader, which make things run faster. It's just some micro optimizations which you want to do in case some of the shaders are not using the root signatures. Now let's take a look on how these binding slots all work together. The first thing we had was this kind of like counting index, which was given by the position on where it is defined inside of the root signature. And this is the so-called API bind slot, which we later use in C++ to actually tell, okay, set this parameter to this GPU address, set this parameter to this descriptor heap handle or whatever. Next thing is most of the time a name or kind of like definition of the type. In this case, it's a root constant, or it could also be a CBV, a URV, whatever. And the next thing we require is the HSL bind slot, also called register. It is defined inside the root signature and used in the shader so that they can link together. It's kind of like a linkage between the root signature and the shaders. Registers have special labels, so actually they are defined on how you build them. Constants and constant buffer views, so you could kind of like say a pointer to some data, is always defined by B for buffer, and then an index, so 0 up to infinity. Shader resource views, because they are most of the time textures, are defined by T and then an index. Unordered access views are defined by U and an index, and samplers are defined by S and an index. Of course, there's also the opportunity to use these spaces, which are kind of like two-dimensional registers. So I say this kind of like already explained how this works. Now we take a look at visibility, because for each parameter of a root signature, you can define a shader visibility. By default, it is visible to all shaders, and it kind of like works the same like the DNA on the whole root signature, but that you can actually control access for special elements or specific elements in the root signature for specific shaders, which also are some micro optimizations that can speed up things. In this case, it's allowed because most of the time a resource or a texture is just used by one or two shaders, but the whole signature is most of the time used by all shaders. So on the root signature side, you say which shaders don't use it, and on the actual root parameters, you define which shaders use them. So it's kind of like logical here. So you can define any shader combination you want with the logical or bitwise or, sorry. How does these entries now look like? We already saw the example here, but I want to go into detail how they are built. CBVs, SRVs, and UAVs are built exactly the same. Expect they have different register, kind of like index by BTU. And first thing you define is the register, and after that you get some optional parameters, for example, the space and the visibility if you want to use it. And since root signature model 1.1, we also have a flag. which just tells the GPU on how the data is accessed, if it is only written or if it is only read, and just leave this at default. It will work at best at default. Maybe if we are gonna encounter a problem where we need to define them, we may take a look at them in the future, but I don't think so that we will need them. So now let's go over to root constant and set exemplars. Root constant are a bit defined differently. First of all, you have to define how many constants are used, and then you of course also need a register, also a space, and also a visibility. Or not need, you can use the space or you can use the visibility, but you need to define how many constants and a register. Another thing is the state exampler. It has some more parameters. We go into the detail and we get two samplers in the DirectX series, but for now we will just don't care about the parameters. We just see that it also has a register, a space, and a visibility. As I already told you, you can also have tables that point to unbound or bound numbers of descriptors, and this is indicated by the descriptor table entry, and the descriptor table entry can have n clauses, and each clause is defined here. So CBV, SRV, UAV, and samplers are allowed, while samplers should be all in one table and the other can be in different tables, but you can't mix samplers and the other things in one table. So by default, you just have the clauses and optionally the possibility to actually also set the shader visibility, but this visibility is for all elements in the descriptor table and you cannot define this on a per descriptor base, because, well, you already have the access to the whole table, because, well, the table is just one copy and you could emit one copy by defining another visibility, but it doesn't make sense to actually disable them on inside the tables, because they are just offsets. So how are things defined in a table? Of course, you need a register again. Then you need the number of descriptors. By default, this is one, so you're just defining one. But you could also put in unbound, or let's say, for example, four, if you define four of the constant buffer views or four textures. Then, of course, you have the space parameter and you have an offset parameter. By default, this offset parameter will just be counter through, so it starts at 0 and ends at n. But you could, for the aliasing purpose, actually define an own index, or you could, if you set the descriptor handle kind of like to a base address, and you know this table has kind of like 16 entries, then you could actually define a special entry which has a special meaning in your descriptor heap here in the offset. But yeah, in most case you just want to start at the index 0 and just go on, but maybe you require it. So after we have defined the root signature, we kind of like need to define some HLSL types as well. Because just defining the root signature and binding it to a shader doesn't mean that inside of the HLSL code you can use it. And this is actually done in several ways. For example, if you have a constant buffer view, you most of the time define a struct, which defines one entry in your constant buffer, and then you just use it by using the keyword constant buffer and kind of like C++ template parameters, type in the type of the struct, give it a name and also a register where it is bound, and then it will automatically be assigned, and in this case it would be one. You could of course also take an array here for elements, and you could also use a array of a two-dimensional array here. Also, even through the registers doesn't match up here, they are just arbitrary data, they are not right here. Same goes for textures, they are also available as default types, unbound textures and the normal array. Also, even through these registers are not right, but, well, they could be used like this. But textures are a special thing, they are not instanced by the constant buffer view, they have a special type called texture 1D, 2D and 3D, and you can also give it the kind of like type of data, and dimension is expected. In this case it would be 4 channel textures, but you could put in whatever you want. Your unordered access view are special things, because they could for example be a texture, then they are defined by RV texture. RV stands for read write, which is basically a universal access view, unordered access views, because they are read write resources. And there could also be a buffer, and if they are a buffer, you also need a type here. So I've created a buffer here with some parameters in there. Root constants are also mapped very easily. You just type in const float, for example, float 4 in this case, my float, and also the registers. Samplers, no matter if they are static or dynamic, are defined by the samplers keyword, even through kind of like Visual Studio Code is unhappy with that sampler keyword. Why is that? I don't have no idea. Yeah, they are also going over registers. So now we actually have defined some members inside of our global members in our HLSL shaders. We have written a root signature that is bound to our HLSL shaders. We have some descriptor heaps in memory with all valid descriptors, and we have a valid heap. Now we kind of like on runtime need to link that pipeline state in. We need to link that descriptor heaps in, we need to link in the root signature in, and after that we need to actually say at the following slot of the or API binding slot of the root signature, I want the following descriptor heap handle, I want the following constant data, I want the following shader resource view, whatever. So you actually need to go in and set them. First of all, the kind of like basic setup, you'll set up the pipeline state by calling the device or the graphic comment list function set pipeline state. Then you set the graphic root signature and the descriptor heaps. The descriptor heaps needs to be set because if they were not set, the index is not interpretable by the GPU. So you actually have to define them, that they are bound. And well, if you do this, then your kind of like pipeline is ready, but now you need to initialize the data in the root signature. This is done by calling one of the set graphic root functions, also device also graphic comment list functions, and you have the same or with the same parameters for constant buffer view, shader resource view, and unordered access view. It requires a uint, which is the root parameter index. So basically, let me just go back a few slides here. Okay, these indices here, these API bind slots, like here, API bind slot, you have to define them in there. And also a GPU virtual address. I already told you, it's kind of like the memory address to the start of this kind of like buffer data. So if you have defined these two, then the data is usable. It works for unordered access view, shader resource view, and constant buffer views. For descriptor tables and root constants, it's a bit different. Descriptor tables also require the index, so the API bind slot. And now they don't require a address because the heap is bind, the descriptor heap is bind with the other functions. So now you actually need to define a handle to the start descriptor, and this is done by this base descriptor parameter. Constants are actually the most easiest thing to set. You also need an index and a number and a destination and a pointer. Even though they have more parameters, they are more easy to set up because this is a CPU side pointer, so just the pointer to the constant data on the CPU we want to set. A value, number of values to set. So in case if you have a flow of 4, which means 4 times 32 bits, this would be 4 in this case. So you want to set 4 32-bit data, 4 floats, then you just point to the first float in that array. Then you also need the destination offset, because you could also just exchange one float by having the parameter at 1 and the offset, for example, at 3. Then you would just exchange one of these 4 floats. But yeah, it's no point in there for now. And I of course also have a root parameter index. So most of the time you would have destination at 0, the offset at 0, the number of bit values to set at size divided by 32 bit, and root parameter index at the current index, and then a pointer to the data. So actually no big deal here. Now let's just take a look into C++ and HLSL and see how this all is working in code. First of all, let's take a look at the shaders, at the root signature. I have defined the root flag allow input assembler input layout, so just very basically, and I just want to have some constants in here. So in this case, I want to have 4 32-bit root constants at the register B0. They are used inside of the vertex shader, so inside of the vertex shader, I want to have a constant float 4. My constant float is this named, and it sits in the register B0. This just defines a global float 4 for the vertex shader. And inside the vertex shader, I take the vertex color, which comes of the vertex buffer, which is a float 3. I add a alpha channel of 1 and multiply it by the constant value given in this register. I also tweaked something in the pixel shader because now I have a float. So you can take a look at the demo. This is now a float 4, but I expected it to be a float 3 because I always want this to be channel 1.0f. So in the pixel shader, I've just written vertex interpolated.color.rgb. So I just taking the RGB values, I cut off the alpha value, so the fourth value, and then I just replace it with 1.0f. It's actually quite nice syntax, which works in HLSL. Now that we have created our shader, let's take a look at the code inside of Visual Studio. First of all, we need to bind our pipeline state. This is done by the function bind, and the function bind just checks the, let me make this a bit bigger, checks the type of the bound comment list and asserts that it matches with the internal type, and then just sets the graphic or compute root signatures, even though we will not use compute in the near future, but I just put it in there so that it is compatible. After that, I just bound the pipeline state as well. So set pipeline state, no problem here. And after that, I need to bind the actual constants. And well, binding constants is a bit more involved because they need to match up the thing that was defined inside the root signature here. And so I've seeked for an easy way to actually write this in C++, and I came up with this solution here, or actually this solution. It is a templated class called root bindings. It works with C++ template magics and variadic templates, so the templates that can take any amount of input arguments. In this case, it takes that many actually root signature entries. And it's very easy because I can define them very nicely. I can just write dx root element in this case, and then I just type dx root type. In this case, I want to have an example, a table, for example. And then I could just write in the d3d12 a GPU descriptor handle here for a table. So I just write in the descriptor. In this case, it's not valid because I currently don't have a handle there. So just an empty object here, but this would, okay, it would not work because I need to expand this to the size of 2, but now it would work, even though IntelliSense has some problem with that. But let me get rid of that because that is not defined inside of our root signature. So back to 1 here again. And what I did here in the kind of like current case, I've just bound a constant. It's a size of float times 2. So size of float is 32-bit, and I want to have 4 floats here, so times 4. And the actual pointer to the float will be FLT, which is just an array of 4 floats. In this case, 1.0, 0.0, 1.0, and again 0.0. So this is actually bind by this is actually bind automatically, and actually I could change these values every frame and they would be up to date every frame. I don't have to do any expensive GPU copy because it's just some root parameters and the root signature is kind of like hard copied every time from the comment list to the GPU. I actually suspect that they are grouped into kind of like this 64 DWords on the CPU and then just uploaded as a block inside of the GPU. But yeah, how it works internally, only the engineers at DirectX 12 knows. So actually I have to bind them as well. I called it BD here for bind descriptors or bind descriptor, and they just bind it here as well. The binding code of that is, hello, can I see it please? So okay, there we go. It's actually quite easy. It just iterates over all of the elements, checks the type, and according to the type calls the appropriate function. For example, here root shader resource view, constant buffer shader, constant buffer view, unordered access view, 32-bit constant, descriptor table, and with all the parameters that are required. I've did some aliasing here with a union, and so it's just very easy to bind them because it all works automatically and with template magic. So yeah, just a very, very short class here. So here we go. A very small class here, which does some amazing work here. So if I just start this application now, I know it runs in release, but I've verified that everything works. You can just see that it runs as expected. It may have less frames because we are now actually setting states on the GPU, which takes time. So we actually reduced our frames here at, let's say, 400 frames per second, which is seems kind of like tragic that we have so many less frames. But this could actually also be because I'm recording. I don't know. Let me just tap out of here and take a look at this in inside graphics, because well, we want to see if everything works. Like the black screen is really hard to tell if things are actually going on right. So I've do some things here. Actually, yeah, you can see we're not completely hitting the 2000 FPS here, but we are getting close, but it is a bit more fluctuating here. Okay, we are still hitting the 2000, so yeah, it's not as stable as before, but it is stable enough for us. It's still plenty of FPS. So yeah, there we go. So now actually at the first sight, nothing has changed because we see no pipeline state at this event. But I actually moved inside of the C++ code. I've moved the begin frame from above here down here because begin frame is a kind of like real event on the GPU that may also take a look at the pipeline state. Actually, it doesn't, but inside graphic deals with that like that. So if I bind this before that begin frame, then I can actually inspect the data that I have bound here. So how do I do this? First of all, I have to switch to the event view. Actually, you can see that I've set graphic root signature here, set pipeline state, set graphic root 32-bit constants, and kind of like these three things that we have done. So basic two things, or one, two basic things, and this automatically, which is currently just one, say index zero, number of parameters four, and the CPU pointer and no offset. But if we take a look at the event, actually you can see events are marked here. And in this case, it is here our clear render target view, which is an event. And as soon as I click here, I can see something down here at the D3D12 root parameters. Now you can see that at index 0, I have a constant of 4 32-bit values, which is actually exactly the same that we have defined here. So a constant at index 0, because flags don't count, with 0 at register 0 and space 0. So we see 0, 0. Okay, visibility is currently at all. But if you now take a look at the right, where we actually can see the root arguments, so this is the root parameters, and these are actually the arguments that are set. You can see that at the register 0, 0, there is something set of the size 16, which is in the global. And this is actually a type of float 4, and its name is my C float. And if we take a look back into Visual Studio Code, at our pixel shader, you see, vertex shader, you see that it is called my C float. And there you go. The value is 1.0, 0.0, 1.0, and 0.0. And as you recall, this is exactly the same value that we have set inside of C++. Let me just cross-check this by setting that all to 1. Terminating the inside graphics session. Terminate it, please. Thank you. So that I can actually build, because I can't build when inside graphics is still accessing the exe. So there we go. Everything compiled. And let's start it again and take another frame capture here. There we go. Take a frame capture. Open up inside graphics and go back to our event. And now you can see all of these values are now at 1, which means that everything we are doing is directly populated to the GPU. And this is actually very nice. You can actually see that everything we want to accomplish has been accomplished, and that we are doing what we actually want to do. So yeah, that's it for this video. In the next video, I think we are finally drawing a triangle. I hope I can put it. I haven't designed the next video, so maybe it will be splitted, and the triangle will be in part 2 or even in the video 2. I'm not quite sure. Maybe I do 2 videos and we are drawing in the video 1 and 2. Or I'm doing 3 videos and we are drawing in video 2 and 3. So yeah, I don't know how I'm doing it, but we are getting close to drawing. So stay tuned, and to the next video. Have a nice day. See you next time. Bye. Now it feels like I've been trying.